The Peace Prize obligates. I want to start by telling the story of a young woman named Lava. Lava is 20 years old and she lives in Congo. She has a 4-year-old daughter. Lava doesn't know who the father of her daughter is. When Lava was 13 years old, she was kidnapped at gunpoint by soldiers from one of Congo's armed groups. For more than 2 years, 6 men raped her over and over again. They dragged me into the jungle. I was scared, but didn't dare to fight back, she says. Her captors, 30 soldiers, had 6 girls that they took turns raping. To deny sex meant being killed on the spot. Luckily, Lava managed to escape. But the war in Congo is still the deadliest in the world. Millions of people have been killed, and people are still being killed. Countless are kept as objects of abuse, staring into the barrel of a gun. Every day, 2,000 people lose their lives as a result of the use of small arms. Tens, perhaps hundreds or thousands more are at any given point terrorized by firearms that anyone can carry. They be grown men or young children. Small arms kill more people than any other kinds of weapons. Small arms are in fact the world's largest weapons of mass destruction. Most armed conflicts today take place in developing countries. Access to arms and ammunition prolongs wars and conflicts. Arms and ammunition does not only kill people, it also destroys everyday lives all over the globe. Poor people, like Lava, are affected the most. Access to arms and ammunition is decisive of armed violence. The bloody war in Congo, where thousands of women are raped as part of the warfare, is only one example of that. Control over the dispersal of small arms and ammunition can prevent killings and the rapes of women and improve the security of people. And there is no doubt, wherever arms are used, there can be no development. U.S. President Barack Obama received the Nobel Peace Prize today. I hope he will fully deserve that honor one day. Today was not the time. We haven't yet seen the results of his contributions. In 2006, American ammunition was found in the eastern parts of Congo. According to the U.S., it's been prohibited to sell ammunition to the area since 1993. But the U.S. has exported small arms ammunition to Congo's neighbors since then. American ammunition has probably found its way to Congo from its neighbors. The arms trade is complex and marked by secrecy, but better control is possible. Last month, the UN decided that the world needs an international agreement to regulate arms trade. This was a historic decision. The U.S. was before starting the process, and we can probably thank Obama for that. But the U.S. is also slowing the process down because they're demanding the right of veto in the negotiations. That implies that we may end up with an agreement which is not effective enough to hinder the inhuman consequences of small arms dispersion. What's it worth then? One of the reasons why Obama won the Peace Prize was his contributions to dialogue in the Middle East. But who is responsible for the fact that one side in the conflict is militarily superior? The U.S., with President Barack Obama as its leader, provides enormous amounts of weapons to Israel that are used to violate international law. Dear Mr. President, I think this was too soon. Nevertheless, since you now have received it, let me underline that the Peace Prize obligates. We have great expectations. You play an important role to achieve control over the world's arms trade. Do it as a Peace Prize winner. Or, to use the same words that you use today, our actions matter and can bend history in the direction of justice. Yes, we can. Yes, you can, if you want to, control arms trade. Thank you.
Vi har en taler igjen, men før hun slipper til, så skal jeg si litt om marsjen etterpå. I hele dag så det flere av oss som står bak denne demonstrasjonen, som har gått fra TV-stasjon til TV-stasjon og radiostasjon til radiostasjon, og et spørsmål vi alltid har fått har vært, blir det bråk da? Jeg vet ikke om de håper at det blir bråk, men det blir selvsagt ikke bråk, og det har vi sagt. Og vi skal, det en viktig ting med dette, og det at vi vil gjerne komme frem til Grand Hotel når Barack Obama kommer ut. Han skal komme ut klokken 18.58, og skal være der til 19.03. Det betyr at, dette helt sant, det betyr at når neste taler har avsluttet, så skal vi altså fylke oss bak to politihester, tre politimenn og hovedplakaten dere ser der borte. Ruten opp Karl Johansgate. Når vi kommer til Nedre Slottsgate, går vi til venstre, opp Prinsensgate, på baksiden av Stortinget og ned mot Eidsvolls plass. Og det jeg sier til dere nå viktig. Politiet og vi vet ikke hvor mange som da står på Eidsvolls plass, i og med at nei til atomvåpen og de som går i det fakkeltoget, hvor mange det vet vi ikke. Er det plass, kan vi gå inn på Eidsvolls plass og stå der og markere de slagordene vi synes er viktige å markere til Barack Obama. Er det fullt? Er vi bedt om, og skal vi gå videre, enten ned mot Spikersuppa, eller til venstre ned Rosenkrantzgaten, hvor det på Rådhusplassen satt opp en stor, stor skjerm, hvor vi kan følge med på alt som gjelder Obama utover. Jeg skal gjenta dette etter neste taler, men det viktig at vi gjør dette ordentlig, slik at vi rekker frem til Obama kommer ut på balkonen. Another important issue we want to raise to President Obama is to stop the Israelis.